First of all, you're talking about the primary need to belong. It's definitely been my experience, especially in working with prisoners, that the need to belong is so important. For all of us, it doesn't matter who we are. And even when we act in ways that seem to give the message to other people that we don't, in fact, want to belong anywhere, it's more a message that we really do. And so I think that's really important. You also made an analogy of the big yellow bus coming at the end of the sentence, and I would even push that analogy to say, be on the yellow bus coming to the prison, and walk the journey with people while they're incarcerated as community people, and then walk out the door with them. And so I think that's really important to do now, probably more than ever. Things change as they always do in the system, and I think it's important to remember we live in a democracy with rule of law, and citizens pay the taxes that support the system, and so you have a right to go and see what's going on and to participate in that, because the problems start in our communities, and they it's not enough for us to sort of relinquish our responsibility and say, I'm going to give this to somebody else and I don't have to worry about it. So I urge everybody, if they haven't thought about it, that that's a really important thing to do. I also think it's really important for community-based agencies to be the ones who are sort of spearheading that, because then our volunteers in places like John Howard and EFRI organizations I've been involved with for the past 30 years, that your volunteers become your citizen ambassadors. It doesn't have to be anybody sitting at a podium saying, believe us, really, it really is good, restorative justice. If people, enough people are inside working with people from the community without pay, then that base is covered. I used to go down to Washington State, and they had a lot of prisoners in this one prison we visited with students. And I was talking to the director of volunteers for the state, and I said, how many do you have? It was like thousands of citizen volunteers. I said, how did you do that in one state? And she said, well, we had a man escape from a Walla Walla institution. It was very dangerous, and we were very worried about it. And he turned himself in 4 days later. When they asked him why, he said, well, he had this citizen volunteer that used to visit him once a week, and he didn't really want to disappoint him, so he figured the best thing to do was to turn himself in. And so apparently when the governor heard that, they said, okay, well, we have to have more volunteers coming into prisons. And so I would say that we need to be doing that. And I think it keeps all of us honest. It, A, tells everybody that we're taking responsibility for problems that we actually deny exist, because we're so individualistic. It's these particular criminogenic factors of this person, but never me. I mean, I can't tell you how many people I've met in prison who thought they were that person until they ended up there themselves. And it's a big surprise that prison contains all kinds of different people with different problems. And today now, it's not the same system 30 year than it was 30 years ago when I went in, and it's just not. I mean, the problems are more acute, and the mental health problems and so on are kind of obvious, and we all need to. I mean, it's not enough to ask a government to take care of it. It's not the government. The government is us anyway. Democracy means people rule. So as people, we should be in there, and it keeps everybody honest. I mean, I'm making maybe subtle or not so subtle references to a Fifth Estate show that was on Friday night that we talked about quite a bit at the conference in different ways in Saskatchewan I just came back from. And I think, you know, if citizen volunteers are around, those kinds of things are less likely to happen, because it keeps everybody honest. When we're always operating as if the eyes of the world are on us all the time, that we will conduct ourselves in decent ways. A friend of mine in Boston borrowed an expression from a Navajo judge and added one word to it. And she said, you can't get to a good place in a bad way, ever. You can't get to a good place in a bad way, ever. Everything that we do in our lives is about acting on the values and being that change, as Gandhi said. And I think that came really through in Pierre's talk too, that You have to change everything. I mean, I always sort of believed it, and part of the sort of inner turmoil about this award thing was, I mean, I talked to my students about how I don't believe in punishment and rewards or awards, and you know, you can't motivate behavior certainly by that way, but I have found belonging and relationship to be the motivator. Absolutely, without question, I believe that with every fiber of my being because I've seen it work. I also liked what you had to, well, a couple of things. Violence is the noise that pain makes. Well, that's a great metaphor. And that's so true. I urge you all to think about concepts such as shame and trauma, which we know an awful lot more about now. The psychiatrist James Gilligan in the United States wrote a book called Violence, the Deadly Epidemic, and he had been a psychiatrist in the men's maximum security prisons for quite a few decades, actually, and he found that the source of violence most often was shame. And he said, imagine the shame of knowing that nobody cares for you. And shame is different than guilt in the sense that shame is a feeling of disgust about oneself, not the action, but oneself, the being. And imagine what it would be like to get out of prison and know that there's not one soul out there that you know who cares about you, cares whether you live or die or to ID your body in the morgue or anything. And his theory was, I think those guys go out and commit another violent act because they know that they'll always be received by a system, a state system that has to care for them. And so it's easier to say, oh, well, you know, I'm a tougher person and, you know, I just don't belong out there, I belong in here, is really about shame and trauma. Then the rule of law, I spoke of that. I've wrestled always, how do you deal with the sort of the forces that say, oh, well, you know, it's the sloganeering. Graham Stewart talks about the sloganeering of things, you know, tough on crime and all these things that people just let drop from their mouths and they don't really put any effort into it. And I met an interesting man by the name of Hirsch Greenberg when I was in Saskatchewan the last couple of days, and he was one of the nominees for this award, and we were chatting at the table, and he works in schools and he works in universities and a lot of the reserves around in Saskatchewan where he lives. And he said he would do school patrols and kids would be fighting with each other in elementary school and sort of duking it out. And he'd stop to them and he says, well, you know, do you think you're tough? Yeah, I'm tough. Do you think you're tough? Yeah, I'm tough. He says, well, do you think you're tough enough to take my tough test? I was like, Mom, yeah, I'm tough. What's your tough? He says, oh, I don't know. I don't think you're tough enough to take my tough test. Maybe it's, I shouldn't be asking elementary school kids. He said, and I walk away and they go, no, we want to do your tough test. And so he'd come back and he said, by then there's a big crowd of kids around. He said, you want to do my tough test? Are you sure? Because now there's all these people. Yeah, he says, okay, hug each other. So the boys go up to each other and they hug each other. And so he says he's done this in daycares and other places and the kids start going. He says, do you want to do the tough test? And the kids just go and they give each other a hug. So it's taking the language of tough on crime and turning it into something different, you know. My tough test is, are you actually tough enough to be able to give a hug to somebody that you're having a dispute with? That would be a sign of toughness rather than your willingness to swing a punch at them. So I thought it was a great metaphor and a great story. Thanks, Hirsch, for that, sharing that with us over the last couple of days. Other than that, I really don't want to take up too much time from everybody else that's here, and often great stuff comes out of the questions. And thanks again, Pierre. It's always inspirational to hear from you. You've been one of my inspiring lights over the years.
I agree with you, Liz, in terms of, you know, the text very little, but I just want to make a comment in terms of one thing. I don't think we should let the government get off the hook too easily. Like Vern White, for example, in Ottawa says, you know, why is it that I have to fight with my committee to justify that I spend a very small amount on restorative justice approaches that work, and I don't have to defend whatsoever for a lot of the police practices that don't work? You know, one question. But also I want to say, You know, that at times, and I'll just use the example, of course, of the circuit of supporting accountability, which is known on so much in Canada, and you know, everybody raves about it, and rightly so. But I remember, like, when it began in Ontario, and the first case with Charles Taylor and different thing, and at some point, like, we felt we had a hot potato. Like, it started out of necessity. Nobody wanted that guy. He went from town to town. And at some point, somebody said, and he said, well, we're going to have a circuit around it. You're on duty on Monday, Tuesday. That's a lot of the real programs in life start out of necessity, a real need, and somebody has the courage to do something about it. But I remember when the 10th anniversary came, you know, CSE, we were bragging about Corsa, what a wonderful, the best thing, you know, after Apple Pie and all this. When the 10th anniversary came, I was invited to go because I had been there in the Picardy. And the commissioner at the time said, I want to go. I think it's a great thing. And the people organizing the 10th anniversary phoned me and they said, we don't want her. And could you go and tell her that? Well, I don't know, some of you knew the commissioner, but it was one of the very hard tasks that I did in my life. I went in. And I said, you know, the 10th anniversary, oh, yes, and I'm excited about going. When I really think we're good together. Well, I said, they don't really want you. You're not welcome. So what do you mean? Well, he said, I said, basically, it's like this. We've been talking, you know, in CSC, what wonderful initiative is COSA. How wonderful it helps people. It saves, you know, money and all this. And you're cutting the funding. You know, there'd be no more funding. We need basic funding some places to get things organized, to have leaders that gather, a lot of volunteers and all that. And I must say, to her credit, she said, well, what is it that we've got? And I told her, well, she said, count on it. Well, I said, then you're most welcome. she came and we celebrated the 10th anniversary. I just wanted to bring the nuance, like in other words, if CSC cannot on one side of its mouth praise all kind of beautiful initiative and not put some funding, minimal funding, behind it, and I know they do it. Restorative Justice Week publishes like all kind of beautiful, you know, documentation, all out of the Restorative Justice branch out of CSC and all kind of initiative. But I just needed to throw in that little thing, my CSC history got me up.